This podcast is brought to you by Free Buddhist Audio, the Dharma for your life. Our work is funded entirely by donations from our generous listeners. If you would like to help us keep this free, make a contribution at freebuddhistaudio.com/donate. Thank you and happy listening.
So I'm going to talk about the first, I get them the wrong way around, the Dasadhamma. Sometimes I call them the Dhammadassas. The first Dasadhamma. So we're looking at that sutta, which is, one translation is, I am no longer living according to worldly aims and values. But before I go into that, I'm going to say a few things by way of introduction. So one of them is that I'm not deeply versed or immersed in systems theory. In fact, I don't really know much about it. I'm here under totally false pretenses, in the way that Kamasuri is, her passion and inspiration, and Parami's done a lot of work with Joanna Macy, so I know a little bit about it, but I'm here as a learner in that respect. But I did get inspired by Kamasuri's talks, or one of her talks, that she gave, and then we thought, us three thought, oh, we could do something around that. And then when we had to come to write the blurb, we were thinking, what exactly were we inspired by? The inspiration was there, but the kind of details weren't. So, yeah, I'm inspired by this. And I think I'm interested in finding new ways to look at existing teachings in a way, just to get fresh perspectives and look at things from a new perspective, you know, putting old wine into new bottles, just because I think we so easily take things for granted that we're kind of very familiar with. And also teachings in our own tradition get kind of lost or forgotten. Mm-hmm. So I'm interested in the whole thing about bringing things back into awareness, into consciousness, and finding new and fresh ways of communicating those values and principles and teachings that will be applicable and fresh and exciting now. Partly because I think then we have more gratitude for what we've learned, even if we've forgotten it. And that gives us confidence and that gives us faith, and that allows us to communicate those teachings and principles and practices with confidence to others. So it is interesting that I think we can forget many things, or things just kind of, they're very current at a particular point in our history and our tradition, and then other things come into play. And we don't, those of us who've been around a long time, forget to make those things kind of conscious again. So one example is an example of Parami, actually, but Parami was on an ordination retreat a few years ago, and so people were getting ordained, and one of those people said that they didn't realise that the sevenfold puja which we use comes from the Bodhicharya Avatara. So, you know, no blame to that person. She'd just never been, that had never been communicated to her. But for Parami and I, that would be quite extraordinary because, I guess, in our history, that was the first seminar Bhante ever did, was on the Bodhicharya Avatara. And we studied and read and recited and recited it in call and response and took days doing it and made all the offerings for a long time. I guess we kind of took it to its kind of fullness, and then something else came along, another seminar, another set of teaching. So things get lost, don't they? And Bhante, I don't know if you know this, but he's been studying with Paramartha recently a Yogacara Sutra called the Sangharakshita Sutra. He told me the other day when I saw him a couple of weeks ago that he's re-studying it with Paramartha for the second time and going through Paramartha's notes. But one of the things that came out of his study was that the sutra, or the compilers of that sutra, saw themselves dealing with the history of Buddhism that they'd received and trying to make what had become implicit explicit. So it's a way you can look at the whole history of Buddhism and the various turnings of the wheel of the Dharma. You could see that. But I think in our own history, things that were explicit, you know, it's the same point I've just made, things that were explicit to me years and years ago, just get lost or forgotten, and we need to sort of bring them out and make them explicit now. So that all kind of interests me very much. And then thinking about the whole language of paradigm shifts, which I do find very interesting, I think Bante doesn't use that particular language, but he uses language about the spiritual life and the Dharma life, as does the Buddhist tradition, which I think maps onto that, obviously, very well. So just some examples. He's got a whole series of lectures called The Meaning of Conversion in Buddhism. So he's talking about conversion. So he's talking about a turning around, isn't he? So the first lecture in that series is about turning away from the world, which is what we're going to talk about later, turning towards the values of the three jewels. And then within that, he says there's a turning around within Dharma practice, which is a turning, the development of insight, a radical transformation. And then another aspect of practice, turning away from a purely individualistic approach to practice to an understanding of the Bodhisattva ideal, and then the turning around in the deepest seat of consciousness. So there's a sense of things shifting and turning, radical transformations. And he uses that terminology, doesn't he? Radical transformation, a radical shift in our centre of gravity, total and radical reorganisation, reorientation of our being and our life and world around the values of the three jewels. So yeah, he uses that language. So in this talk, we're going to look at going forth, I guess, leaving behind the worldly aims and values of the group. And it's interesting, if you go back to Bante, a lot of his teaching in the 70s, where he explores this material, he explores the group, the individual, and the spiritual community. So there's a number of lectures around the same time, authority and the individual and the new society, a vision of history. Can the spiritual community save the world? Buddhism in blasphemy, Buddhism in world peace, Buddhism in nuclear war, transforming self and world. So a whole series of talks. And I guess what you learn from that is that Bante has always been very, very keen, still keen, to make sure that we as individuals have the conditions and the resources and the practices that enable us to transform ourselves. But then he's also been very, very keen that we come together and form spiritual communities, which give us more resources and more conditions in order to grow. But it doesn't ever stop there with Bante, does it? So he wants us to form a spiritual community, but he wants us to be part of a live, active spiritual community so that we can influence and change the world. So he's always been radical. Parami gave a talk recently called Radical Then and Radical Now. So Sangharakshita is a radical teacher, and he wants us to make these kind of radical shifts in our lives and worlds. So I came across, I was trying to find the lecture with the earthworm quote in it, and it's in Evolution and Extinction, a Buddhist approach to current world problems. So I was putting that in Free Buddhist Audio, and it came up also with a talk by Nyanavacha. So I think it was in 2012 at the LBC. The LBC on Monday nights, they have in their Monday night class a seminar, ongoing seminars, which are often taught by Nyanavacha, Subhadramati, Maitreya Banda. So this one in 2012 was called Sangharakshita Classics. So there's a whole series of talks by Bante, lectures by Bante, old lectures by Bante, of different aspects of his teaching. And Nyanavacha had taken Evolution and Extinction. So I thought it was very good what he did in terms of making the implicit explicit. So he's got the transcript of the talk. He's in a seminar. I don't know how many people go to those classes. Often lots. And so he takes a section of the talk and he reads out paragraphs. And then he kind of riffs on it from his own examples, how that applies now. Takes questions from the floor. So a very, very good way of bringing that material into the present, I thought. So when I was doing a little bit of reading around what is a paradigm and what is a paradigm shift, I came across a quote, and I didn't write down who it was from, sadly, but the person writing the article referred to paradigm pioneers, which I thought was a fantastic term, paradigm pioneers. So that's people with the courage and the conviction to go into the unknown, because a paradigm shift, it takes you into the unknown. You don't know what that's going to be like before you're there, I guess. And this person said they're often outsiders or on the fringes of a particular discipline. So I guess, you know, paradigm shifts comes from the discipline of science. So I guess it would be people kind of working in a particular edge of something. And they're often ridiculed at the beginning of their discoveries, even though those discoveries might be taken as the norm later. So you've got the whole kind of heliocentric view of the universe, Copernicus, and then Galileo, Galileo and the Inquisition, etc., etc. And eventually that becomes, through greater technology and understanding and mathematics, that becomes the accepted worldview from the flat world, and etc. There's a sort of tipping point where things then become accepted. And I thought that Bhante is very much a paradigm pioneer. And some of us were in the puja last night where Parami read from, I think it was from Nucleus of a New Society, he read Bhante's story about founding the movement. Very, very strong, wasn't it? Mm. And I had thought of having this quote here, but, you know, we already had it last night, where he's saying that he got the letter in Kalimpong saying, yeah, don't bother to come back, we don't really want you, and that he had that kind of vision of knowing what he needed to do, which was start a new movement. I mean, I'm not sure if I got a letter saying, don't want you, don't come back. I'd have had that response. So, you know, it was a very particular individual, wasn't it, with a very particular response. And he had a choice to, not that his life wasn't spiritually and dharmically challenging in Kalimpong, but he had a lot of support and resources to come back to the UK in the 60s. With, you know, a few friends, but, you know, no money, no support, and as he said, possibly every door shut against him. So he made that choice. It was an extraordinary thing to have done. So, you know, he's a paradigm pioneer. We mentioned Dr. Ambedkar yesterday as well as a paradigm pioneer. So I'm sure there are many paradigm pioneers in all kind of traditions in the world. I couldn't think of any women offhand, but I'm sure there are many. And I just wondered whether actually the Pope is a paradigm pioneer. Our present Pope, it's interesting, isn't it? Because he's the head of this huge group, as it were. The Roman Catholic Church is a spiritual tradition, it's a religion, but it's also has many, many aspects of the group, doesn't it? But as an individual, he's using, I guess, his own kind of conviction, he's a scientist, to write an encyclical about climate change. So that's really interesting, isn't it? He says he wants to bring an ethical dimension to the communication around climate change, which is a thing that kind of faces us and the future of our planet and ourselves, isn't it, at the moment. And he's going to be very unpopular with his own Vatican right-wingers. They dealt with the Catholic Church in America, politicians in America, big business. So it's just very interesting, isn't it? He's not kind of on the fringes of something. And yet, you know, he's brought something into consciousness. And maybe, because of who he is, he can have quite a big effect in that dialogue. Anyway, it's interesting, isn't it? Okay, so that's all by way of introduction. So the first Dhammadasa, is to be reflected on again and again by one who has gone forth. So in this context, we're not meaning monastics, we're meaning people in our spiritual tradition and community. So there are other translations of that. That's the one we thought was most sort of straightforward when we looked at the different translations. But they are interesting to look at. So one says, I have now changed into a different mode of life from being a householder. So again, we're not divided into householders and monastics, but there's an implication of a change in your life from your commitment at whatever level your commitment is. A common translation is, I have become casteless. I do not belong to any caste. So we talked a little bit about that yesterday. Kemashuri talked about that in relation to Indian society and how important and radical that is in that tradition, in that society. And Subhuti made a set of reflections around the 10 Dasadhammas for the Indian Order some years ago. I don't know when it was. So his reflection was, I have entered upon a casteless state. I am free from group identity, and I have left behind membership of the group. I do not identify with class, race, nation, faction, or gender. So this first reflection is about leaving the group. And as I said, Bhante's got a lot of teachings about the group, the individual and the spiritual community. So I'm going to bring some of these back into our awareness and see what we think of them now. So he says, and we talked about this yesterday from the systems point of view, he says the group and the spiritual community exist in a relationship. So we had this idea of nested holons, didn't we, that, the systems interact. And he says it's often, perhaps most often, a relationship of tension, dialectic, there's a kind of to and fro, and sometimes even of battle. So they can be diametrically opposed because they're based on different values, aims, and principles. And yet, individuals emerge from the group, aspiring individuals emerge from the group, or perhaps from the positive group, and then join together, as it were, to form spiritual communities. So we need to be in relationship. There needs to be a relationship between the group and the spiritual community and the individuals within it. And I guess there's that saying, isn't there, we're in but not of the world. So one of Bhante's quotes about the group is, the group is always wrong, which is interesting, isn't it? The group is always wrong. And that's because, he says, the group is based on power or authority. And in his lecture on authority and the individual in the new society, he talks about representation. So you have representation within the group. One person can represent another, which is only possible in a power hierarchy. Because you're doing it on the basis of position or office, and you're not doing it as an individual. And he goes into long stories about, you know, not being seen as an individual. Why do Buddhists do this, or why do Buddhists do that, or why did he start World War II, or whatever. Stories about that. So the group is based on power, and I guess it can be based on extreme forms of power and extreme forms of violence, but it can also have, within the group, can't it, be much more subtle forms of power, so coercion, exploitation, manipulation, fraud, deceit, hypocrisy, all those kind of, much more subtle. And if you've ever studied the Bodhisattva precepts, fraud, deceit, and hypocrisy are seen to be things that, you know, not to engage in, because they distance you and polarize you with other human beings. So the purpose of the group, I'm sort of riffing on Bhante, is conformity. It's to make a good group member. It could be a good family member, it could be a good soldier, etc., etc. But to enable people to conform to group values and aims, to sort of coerce in subtle ways for that to happen. So the purpose of the group is to make us to conform to group patterns and norms and the assumptions and values that underlie the particular groups. And I was thinking a little bit, we touched on this yesterday, the whole thing about secular mindfulness. I mean, it's a huge discussion, but I think the criticisms of secular mindfulness are that it's not the whole Dharma, because it's one aspect of the Eightfold Path. And I guess it can be taught as a way to kind of reduce your stress so that you're more productive within the groups that you're operating within, rather than transforming life and society. Idyamana was telling me about a conversation that she was witnessing. She's, you know, very interested in mindfulness, between two people. So one person was saying, mindfulness is not the Dharma. Secular mindfulness is not the Dharma. And the other person was saying, but it is, because it helps people. So you've got kind of a polarisation, haven't you, about something that's kind of important to us all, mindfulness practice. And in a way, if we could be a little bit more subtle and nuanced about those kind of discussions, I guess person A would say secular mindfulness is not the whole of the Dharma, because it doesn't take in the other aspects of the Eightfold Path. And this person would be saying, but it helps people, and you know, whatever helps people is the Dharma. It's sort of a bodhisattva ideal approach, isn't it? So in these kind of conversations, it would be good to be a little more subtle sometimes than we sometimes are. Yes, yeah, so the group, in the way that I've defined it, which is the way that Bhante defines it, is obviously often antagonistic to the individual, because the individual, the aspiring individual, is trying to emerge and think for themselves and feel for themselves, have their own values and assumptions, to stand out and to question, to turn around and kind of question the group values. And often that puts people's lives on the line, or puts people's lives at risk. And we know that whistleblowers suffer, you know, persecuted. When we were doing the bodhicitta practice yesterday, I know that what was suggested to us that we pick someone that we knew, but I just had this very strong image of this guy in Saudi Arabia who had his own blog and was trying to, you know, have some kind of discussion of ideas, some kind of movement towards free speech, and he's in prison, sentenced to this terrible kind of punishment of being lashed, 100 times a week. I mean, the second week has never happened because I think he's just not well enough, but I could just see his face in front of me and thinking, you know, that you sort of try and stand up against a very, very strong group in that particular culture, and, you know, the penalties can be huge. So our paradigm pioneers are very, very courageous and very brave. So the group has a sort of strong hold on us, and I think we mustn't underestimate that our ties to the group go very, very deep. And, you know, there's a lot of unconscious assumptions. And we have a huge desire to belong. We have a huge need to belong. And, you know, in a tribal situation where if you were ostracized for any reason or shunned and you were outside of that group, your survival would be at risk. You wouldn't have the physical resources to survive, you wouldn't have the emotional resources to survive. So that's still kind of there somewhere down there, isn't it? That kind of need for belonging, need for, it's a sort of survival instinct. So we're tied to various groups that we were looking at yesterday, you know, family ties of blood, tribe, nation, very deep ties that we're not totally conscious of. And this paradigm shift to leave the group and leave behind worldly aims and values is, we're asking a lot of ourselves and others. And perhaps we shouldn't kind of underestimate that. And I think one of the things that did strike me in Kamasuri's talk, that she gave on one of the women's events, was she said this yesterday in her talk, that a paradigm shift can happen in a flash, but usually it's a very hard thing to shift. And you said in the talk you gave that you wondered if that's sometimes why the ordination process is quite long. And that really kind of struck me, because I've been involved in ordination processes for many, many years, and that sort of training from, you know, to use different language, provisional going for refuge to effective going for refuge, it doesn't have to take a long time, but it can take a long time. It's another way of looking at why that might be, isn't it? That, you know, we're asking people to begin to make this very, very deep shift from worldly aims and values, to leave the group, to become at least an aspiring individual, so to be able to join an effective spiritual community, which is trying to become a real spiritual community. So yeah, that's I found that just very interesting. So we need, when we're in the ordination training, and we need to continue kind of leaving behind worldly aims and values all the way through our spiritual life, but we're continually looking for an openness to change, you know, to spiritual death, really, aren't we? So I guess worldly aims and values. We were talking about, Kamasuri was talking yesterday about the order is, it's just a different animal to any other kind of organisation. But we don't know what that's like until we're in it, and even then we don't often know what it's like. So we're trying to be part of something. It's very, very new, aren't we? So it's not surprising that people coming up for ordination, they kind of want to know what they have to do. And we were talking about this in a private preceptors group the other day, that people look for signs. You know, again, it's perfectly natural. So, you know, somebody says, oh, my friend Mitra so-and-so, you know, they were asked to look for a private public preceptor, so that must mean they're close to ordination. So I've been asked that, so I must be close to ordination. So you're trying to find external things that kind of show you where you're at. And you do need some external things, like the six guidelines are very good at looking at practice. But it's not really about that, isn't it? And we talk about joining the order, so maybe it's understandable that people think in terms of joining something that they're familiar with, and there's things you can do that. So we're looking for kind of a letting go, in a way, a kind of spiritual death, where we're not trying to sort of, I'm not suggesting anyone here is doing that, tick the boxes or do the right thing or have some kind of control over the outcome, because you just can't. You can work, you can practice, you can grow and develop, and at some point, you know, your going fresh will become effective, but it doesn't work in that sort of way. And that's all part of the process, is understanding that and letting go of that. And so it can't be a kind of add-on to our existing life, can it? Spiritual life, spiritual transformation. It just can't be. And I think sometimes people see it. We're in a sort of let's-have-it-all society, aren't we? So we want the ordination as well as everything else we've got. And it just doesn't work that way. Yeah, so I was sort of struck by Kemisuri's remark that maybe that's why sometimes the ordination training takes a long time, because we're trying to make a very, very deep shift, and then we're continuing to try and make that shift in our order life. So Bhante talks about the things we need to leave when we leave the group. And he often starts with the family, doesn't he? Somewhere he says it's the group writ large. It's the family and the whole, maybe the whole romantic ideal in our culture. And I think in one of the groups we had yesterday, when we were looking at assumptions in society, it was your group, Parami, wasn't it? You were looking quite a lot at what that meant. So maybe that's something we can discuss more amongst ourselves. But I think by that he means the nuclear claustrophobic family unit. I guess where it's very, very hard to express one's individuality. And you need to balance that with a whole raft of Bhante's teaching, where he encourages us to be on good terms with our family from the point of view of metta. Because we just owe such a huge debt of gratitude to our family, particularly to our parents, whatever else they've done for us, they gave us life, and that allows us to practice spiritually. But I guess if we feel constrained and we can't be ourselves in our family, maybe we do need to distance ourselves for periods of time, or a period of time in our practice life. I mean, I guess we all know, you know, you're sort of an aspiring and emerging individual and you're doing very well and you're in a good context, and then you go back to your family and, well, in my case, it would take about 5 minutes with my mum and I'd be a three-year-old. You know, I don't know, the dynamic would be like that. So, you know, it's hard to be who you've become, you know, and it's understandable again, isn't it, often in the family dynamic. Being kind of quite old now and having done a lot of work on those tendencies, my relationship with my mother changed dramatically, and it became much more of a sort of individual relationship based on love, and at the end of her life was very, very different. So, and it's worth pursuing with that, because it makes such a difference to one's own kind of life as well as her life. It's part of spiritual practice, isn't it? But yeah, there is a sense we need to you know, be able to be independent and free and think our own thoughts, and not be caught up in the strings that families often kind of want to hold us to. We talked yesterday about moving away from identification with caste and how important that was in India. So I'm not going to go more into that today. But class is another aspect, isn't it? I think that's maybe much more relevant to... I'm going to talk about England. I'm not only going to talk about England. I don't know about Scotland or Ireland or Wales. But I think England is a very class-ridden country. And I remember many, many years ago, I lived in New Zealand for a couple of years, which is a, you know, similar culture, but actually different culture. When I came back to England, I just could see how class-ridden we were, all sorts of interactions and communications. I can't give you details, but I just thought, wow, this is so strong. And I don't know if it's stronger now. It's probably different now. The sort of financial differential is so different, isn't it, that it probably operates differently. But again, I think loosening up identification with class is not easy. So I'm working class, white, poor but honest background, not cultured, and I've got two university degrees, and, in some ways I've transcended that. But at times, I feel my class background very strongly. I feel it, I have to confess, in relationship with the government, mainly educated at Eton. And sometimes, because there was very little culture in my background, I'm in an art gallery. If I'm on my own, particularly, I go to an art gallery, and a particular kind of audience of the art gallery is present. Very lovely people, but they're very middle class, they're very cultured, they talk about art, and I just feel I shouldn't be here. I have that sort of thought. I mean, I don't go away, I stay and listen to what they're saying because it's educative, but there's that kind of something happens, So there's still an identification with my class background that crops up. Parami and I talk about this quite a lot over the years, don't we? And, you come from different class backgrounds, but so it's worth, just noticing those things. And I guess with anything that we're trying to move away from, be it class or tribe or race or nation or faction or gender, we need to, we're not denying that that's where we come from. All of that's, I'm English, I'm white, I'm working class, I'm a woman. But it's not identifying with that to such an extent that you polarise with people who are different, because polarisation sets up antagonism and it sets up possibly hatred and so on and so forth. So have to know who you are, but not identify it with so strongly. And so these things are quite challenging, I think. Gender, that's a huge issue, isn't it? And we're in a kind of a time where things are becoming very fluid around gender. It would be great to hear more about your experience of shifting paradigms in the area of non-binary gender. So I was just thinking about my history in the movement. I won't go into all that in great detail, but often gender gets left off the table. It's very interesting. I think a couple of instances where it's just got left off. It's a bit like yesterday we were looking at groups and Apple technology was completely not on the table. Most of us use it. So I remember being at a convention in 1976, which was called Unity and Diversity in the Order, and we were exploring issues of caste, possibly. Certainly class, race, I can't remember what else, and the whole issue of gender was not on the table, and yet there was it was the elephant under the carpet, it was a huge issue, and some brave paradigm pioneer, Marichi, said, gender? And then we had this huge discussion about what had gone on that day and all sorts of things, but it was just really interesting that it wasn't there. And then many, many, many years later, Subhuti was encouraging us, as a private preceptors gathering, to really understand our own character and conditioning much more deeply. And he was talking about his experience of his particular education, public school, sort of naval public school, accent, the way he talks, and becoming aware that you can't really help it in a way, but that has an impact on others and trying to take that into account. So he was putting things up on a board. He said, anything else? And they went, gender. Not there. Don't know why that is. Anyway, it is a big topic about, accepting who we are, but not identifying strongly. And maybe that's a topic that we could discuss much more fully or have a presentation on in this particular time in our history when things are changing dramatically. So discussion on those areas would be good. So thinking about this, the whole teaching about the group, the individual, and the spiritual community, I wonder if it's still, taught very much or still popular. And I think maybe one of the reasons why it might not be is I think that in my young day in the order, we were quite strongly kind of, we're a spiritual community, we're not a group, and there's the group. It was kind of had an exclusivity about it, which I think has changed for the better. And we're much more sort of inclusive. And I know that the whole thing about leaving family behind, one of the things I've noticed about, again, life at the LBC, is that when people become mitras, often they bring their family with them to the ceremony. They bring their friends who aren't Buddhists, they bring their family. I think that's fantastic, because you're bringing people you're very strongly related to into the Buddhist world, the Buddhist environment, the centre, and, you know, hoping there's some kind of influence there, I guess. But just for them to be part of that step you're making. So I think things have sort of shifted in society in some ways. My own impression, and you can't say this across the board, but that there's less of a kind of, I want to leave my family completely, and you know, people get on with their parents often better, I think. But I guess there's that's interesting if that's true, and we could talk about that. So one doesn't want to be too like they're over there, they're the group, because that isn't really how it is. But I guess you could be too inclusive, maybe. That's another danger where we're so judgmental about being judgmental that we don't want to discriminate. And, you know, we're not really looking at one of the group values that we're trying to leave behind. So maybe that's something to think about. So that's Bhante's teaching on the group, or some of it. The spiritual community, on the other hand, going back to the principles it's based on, is based, of course, on the love mode. I'm going to say a bit more about power mode, love mode, when we come onto the ethical reflections in a couple of days' time. But he says that, you know, ideally the spiritual community is totally without power, totally without coercion in any of its aspects. And it's based on love. And it's not just love, but it's Maha Maitri, Maha Karuna, which is bodhicitta, of course. So we've been doing the bodhicitta practice every morning on the retreat. And he says, somewhere he describes the bodhicitta as a non-egoic stream of spiritual energy. And when he's describing the spiritual community, he says that that is reflected in the hearts and minds of all individuals within the spiritual community. All are imbued with bodhicitta. And in the spiritual community, we cultivate and communicate not only love and compassion, but friendliness, sympathy, encouragement, gratitude, patience, forgiveness, etc., etc. So whereas the group, its purpose is to create conformity, the spiritual community's purpose and founding principle, if you like, is to encourage freedom, spontaneity, originality, creativity, cooperation, and communication. So Bhante's described the qualities of the true individual and the aspiring individual on many, many occasions, so I won't go into them in any great detail, but awareness, spiritual positivity. I think emotional and psychological independence are important, because we are dependent on others, but we need as individuals to be emotionally and psychologically as independent as we can be. And many, many other qualities that he's talked about. So yeah, so there's a tension and a dialectic between the group and the spiritual community. And Bhante says, well, by nature, the spiritual community will be small and few. And nevertheless, it can have an influence on the group. He says it can have a civilizing influence, a softening influence, and it can offer culture and creative values. But there's always the danger of the spiritual community falling back into being a group. And I guess that can be forces outside. The group is so great that it just kind of sucks you back in. It's very, very hard to maintain that withdrawal. But it can be from within. It can be that, I mean, if it was a true spiritual community of stream entrance and beyond, that probably wouldn't happen. But as an aspiring spiritual community, I guess there's always the possibility of stagnation and paralysis from within, or disharmony. And Bhante says, well, if those things happen, you have to re-found a spiritual community. So there's a relationship between them. And even as far back in the 1970s, when Bhante was giving these various talks where he talks about this, he said he thought that the balance between the group and the spiritual community, the relationship between the group and the spiritual community, was out of balance. So that's quite a long time ago, and I would have thought that's possibly more so now, because we were faced with enormous issues. And I'll give you the reasons that he gave then and look and see, you know, what we think about now. So they're interesting. So one of them is population increase. And that's because he says it's very, very hard for people to have space, to get away and have space in order to think your own thoughts and feel your own feelings and develop that emotional and psychological independence. So I guess the whole thing about retreats and solitaries and space and time are very, very important. And that gets more and more difficult for people, the greater the density of the population. Now, I don't know the growth in the population from then to now, but I would imagine it's pretty big increase, yeah. So that was the first one. The second one was what he calls the corporate state taking over everywhere. So, I mean, I guess many of us have been reading Vardika's book, where he kind of talks about some of these things, doesn't he? But the long and total global reach of multinationals and the deregulated market neoliberal capitalism, which is kind of global, isn't it? It kind of just reaches everywhere. So that was then, this is now. It's very, very hard to not be, it's impossible not to be affected by that, isn't it? I'm a Facebooker, which, you know, I get these things posted sometimes. One recently was somebody saying, human beings don't have a right to water. so the whole area there. Modern technology, so that was interesting, modern technology in 1970, I was thinking, what would that have been? So, reel-to-reel tape recorder, a landline phone for some people. Too much telly. But I mean, that, you know, it's an incredible shift, isn't there, in the amount of technology now that, you know, we take for granted, particularly younger generations who've just grown up with the internet. Some of us didn't. And it's got kind of pros and cons, isn't it? So there's a whole surveillance culture, isn't there, where, you know, everything reaches into every aspect of your life. You know, you do a search for something on Google that you might want to buy, and then probably on Google, and then when you go on Google Mail, you've got all these adverts, yeah. You know, so you've been tracked and traced and presented with what they think you might like. yes, there's all sorts of aspects of that, aren't there? And there's an enormous capacity for distraction, of course, which we know. And there's a tremendous opportunity for connection. We've got a tremendous opportunity for connection if we use it well. We can reach enormous numbers of people. high standard of living was one of the things he said. Increasingly high standard of living. And again, we're in a situation where probably the differential between the haves and the have-nots is kind of increasing, isn't it? It's greater than it's ever been, you know, in modern life. And again, he said that's got pros and cons. So owning a car gives you greater freedom, but then you're tied up in a car-owning society, and all that involves more and more roads, petrol consumption, etc. So, yeah, it's just interesting that, you know, he thinks the relationship between the spiritual community and the group was out of balance then. And, it's something we can discuss. Is it out of balance now? Is it more out of balance now? What do we think about that? How does that make us feel? Because then he was saying, well, often our response is to feel rage, and then we can't really do very much. And then we feel overwhelmed. Then we feel despair. We just feel disempowered and powerless. How can we change, you know, the kind of globalised group, as it were, in the way that it is. And so we kind of retreat, we withdraw, is one tactic, isn't it, one strategy, which, you know, again, is understandable. But he says it's not worthy of being a human being. It's not worthy of you being a human being to just be overwhelmed and withdraw. It's very, very strong, isn't it? Yeah. So he said then, and I'm sure he would say now even more so, that we are in a non-violent battle with the group and that we must be outgoing, we must be on the offensive, we must take our values into the world and be heard, and that is better done when we are a participating part of a spiritual community. So, yeah. So, yeah, just a little bit more about the group that we're trying to influence, leave and influence. And I think we're in a world system, an economic system, which promotes certain values very strongly. So greed is good. We all saw Wall Street, didn't we, in the 80s, the speech by Gordon Gekko in the movie Greed is Good. And that's still very much, I think, the ethos of the neoliberal capitalist economic model, isn't it? Profit at all costs. And that leads to everything becomes commodified. People, you know, water, resources becomes commodified. And without a thought of consequence, it seems to be. It's an extraordinary kind of view that, you know, you don't think about the consequences of that for other human beings, for your future descendants, for the planet, etc., etc. It's just extraordinary, isn't it? And it does lead to this ever-increasing kind of differential, doesn't it, inequality. And that has repercussions probably of huge poverty and then envy and strife, etc. And there's a quote in Vardika's book, and he also uses it in one of his talks. It's not from him, I can't remember who it's from, but he got a little round of applause for it when he gave it in one of his talks, where he says that we are encouraged to spend money that we don't have, to buy stuff that we don't want, to make an impression that doesn't last on folk that we don't really care about. Yeah, so not a great way to live, is it? So this is what we're kind of up against, isn't it, in this first reflection. So I think the worst norms of that kind of ethos and economic culture in modern society is to encourage us to be greedy. That encourages us to be competitive, selfish, separate, me. There's also an encouragement to be busy, superficial, materialistic. The religion is shopping, celebrity culture, and escapism and hedonism of all kinds. So that's the kind of the worst aspects of modern culture, isn't it? So our challenge is to turn away from that as much as we can and to live by different aims and values. And we know what those aims and values are. We're fortunate that we know what those aims and values are. They're the Dharmic Buddhist aims and values. And that, you know, they're what we try to create in our own lives and practice and in Triratna. So we're trying to counter greed with a passion for the Dharma, with contentment, with a simple life, with a Dharma economy where possible, having fewness of possessions, being easily supported. It's a line from the Metta Sutra, isn't it? And trying to come together and live and work in love and friendship and cooperation and harmony. So it's a big task. Let's not underestimate the task. So I think the question, I'm not going to answer that question, I don't know how to answer it, is can we, how can we, what can we do to move away from those worldly aims and values in our own life and practice together as a spiritual community? And can we really tip things around? Can we really change that kind of prevailing ethos? Do we really believe that we can? And if we're kind of a bit, God, what do we do? Then we need to come together and give each other confidence to do that. So I'm going to conclude with the quote of around the earthworm from Evolution or Extinction, A Buddhist View of Current World Problems. I love this earthworm idea. And maybe we need to be more than earthworms, I don't know. But anyway, this is Bhante back in the 1970s talking about the relationship between the group and the spiritual community. He says, you will never have one worldwide spiritual community. It would then very rapidly become a group. But you could have a sort of network of spiritual communities which extend all over the globe, and many of the members of which are in contact with one another, which exert a sort of silent, unseen influence. A few days ago, I was reading a very beautiful poem by a modern poet, and it ended on a rather earthy note. The author of the poem concluded by saying, "What are we?" She was talking about what we would call individuals, and she said, "We are earthworms." To be an earthworm is a very high ideal. We are earthworms because we are just burrowing underneath the foundations of the existing order, and the earthworm is a very humble, insignificant creature. But if enough little earthworms just burrow away underneath the foundations of even the loftiest and strongest buildings, they loosen the soil, so the soil starts crumbling away. The foundations will subside. So we must be more like that, like earthworms. So after reading this poem, I said to the friend who was with me, I said, maybe it wouldn't be a bad idea to have a magazine and call it The Earthworm. For this is really our function to be, as it were, earthworms. So if a sufficiently large number of people, of individuals, are, as it were, earthworms, burrowing, tunnelling, withdrawing their support, loosening the soil, then these, not only these structures, these groups, but the current world problems associated with them will sort of, we may say, collapse. The centre of gravity will shift. The centre of gravity in world affairs will shift if this sort of thing happens. It will shift from the conflicting group or groups to the cooperating, indirectly or directly cooperating spiritual communities. And when that is achieved, sorry, this is a transcript, so it's a bit, the grammar isn't very good. The influence of the spiritual community and of the individuals will outweigh the influence of the groups. Then humanity as a whole, practically, will have passed into a higher new stage of evolution of human history, in what we might even describe as a fifth period of human history. And all of this is possible, all of this can be achieved, but it's very big and rather terrible, and because we may not have very much time left. So it becomes the duty in this sort of situation of every thinking human being to take very serious stock of his or her own position. It becomes everybody's duty to give very serious consideration to the view which at least one Buddhist takes of current world problems.
We hope you enjoyed this week's podcast. Please help us keep this free. Make a contribution at freebuddhistaudio.com/donate. And thank you.